Sci-Fi, first and foremost, for inviting me back. It's always good to know that, right? Like, you give a talk and they like you enough and they say, come do this again. All right, we're going to talk about something totally different than the last time I spoke here. And I will try to keep the talk within kind of the limited time that he's given me. Something that's kind of very near and dear to my heart. This is actually the main topic of my doctoral dissertation, which I defended about a year ago. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Brian. I'm a professor at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in the Information Technology and Web Science Department. I've been there for a number of years because I did my PhD there in the Science and Technology Studies Department. So I know a lot about RPI, I know about, a lot about upstate New York. And I kind of do this whole diversity tech thing both in my research and now, very fortunately, because they let me, in my teaching. So I'm going to talk a bit about kind of making diversity a reality. So these would be lessons that I have learned through my research with a group called Hypatia Software Organization, which is a hacker collective comprised, with the exception of me, entirely of transgender women who make it a mission to kind of normalize the trans experience within tech. So I'll talk a bit about that. Also, my slides are super boring. They're really just reminders to me. There's like no fun pictures, none of that stuff. It's just like things I have to remember to say as I'm talking. Right, so Hypatia Software Organization is the group that I work with. This is our logo. We've been around since about, let's see, it's 2019 now, so about 2015, 2016-ish. Slow going in the beginning, we kind of picked up more steam really 2017 to present. What people primarily know us for, if you know us at all, is kind of our peer mentorship program. The idea that we try to get trans women who are experienced in the tech world to be mentors to teach newer neophyte trans women kind of the basics of IT, basics of tech, usually some sort of intro to Python course or some intro to system administration course. And then hopefully our main goal then is to kind of work with a trusted network of employers to kind of land them their first jobs in So I'll talk a little bit about all that stuff. But first I kind of want to talk about like a prehistory of diversity in tech, right? It wasn't planned at all between Sidepocket and I, but it just so happens that diversity in tech has kind of been in the news lately, right? After some things with some people who are famous within free software. Right? Don't even go to names or topics or anything like that, because I think we all know where we're going with that. But I do want to spend some time talking about kind of the prehistory of diversity in tech. This is important to kind of think about where we're going and why we're kind of going in that direction. So it's really important to remember that when computer science was first founded as a discipline, it was not only not unusual, but totally expected that women in particular would be attracted and do well in computer science. Right? So if you look at the history of computer science as a discipline, it is born out of mathematics. Mathematics was a discipline that was always considered appropriate and normal and expected for women not only to be in those disciplines, but to excel in those disciplines. Right? So, right, in the 1920s, 1930s, when we first see kind of the big first push for data entry, right? Think about even 3D mainframes, right? We're hiring in the United States kind of the best and brightest women we have in droves and teaching them to be mathematicians so that they can do data entry, right, for large companies. Right, we think about World War II with the ENIAC, right, before computers were these machines. Computers were the people that programmed those machines, and of course the seven computers of the ENIAC were all women. Right? So the prehistory of diversity in tech is one where, at least along the gender basis, right? Unfortunately, I'm going to avoid talking about race, not because I don't want to, but because it's a little bit outside of Hypatia's scope and what they've been able to do in the last 5 years. But hopefully we can talk about what the future might look like. Right, but it's important to remember that kind of the future that we're trying to get to, right, these events and these people, right, and this toxicity that we're trying to get past is not the way this discipline started, right? And so because of that, it doesn't have to be the way this discipline ends, right? The shift kind of happens when computer science as a discipline is able to become big enough to break free of mathematics. It ends up aligning itself with engineering, which is very male-dominated, has kind of macho sort of characteristics, particularly in the United States. And right, you can see in the early 1980s, right, the number of women who both sign up for CS programs and finish CS programs in college kind of like falls off a cliff. It really hasn't gone back to those pre-early 1980s levels. right? So it's kind of a little history to kind of have us thinking about what diversity in tech was, could be, why did it change, how did it change, what did we do about it. All right, so, right, enter kind of Hypatia into all of this, right? So Hypatia starts in about 2015, around sometime in late August, or it's just around its birthday time, by a trans woman named Lillian. We kind of last named another identifying info out. Lillian was a really interesting case, right? She had been homeless for a number of years. She'd been driven to sex work for a number of years, kind of in order to pay the bills and get by in life. However, she was always pretty skilled in coding and in open source. And I kind of ran into her through totally kind of happenstance means, through my own kind of roamings around open source. We ended up crossing paths through some software she had created. And in about late August, she ends up landing a job where she goes from making virtually no income to making, well, actually really, really good, not only a livable income, but a luxuriously livable income. So in her mind, she had to kind of think of how do we replicate this? How can we take this particular bit of success and replicate it? Right? Her being very conscious of the fact that she's not the only person in this position. Right? Because she's not the only one in this position, there are probably others out in the world who would not only appreciate this kind of opportunity, but excel much like she did in this opportunity. Right? So her goal was to replicate this for as many people as possible. I kind of got in on the ground floor. We were chatting about this when it was kind of fresh in her mind. So I'm technically member number two of Hypatia, and I guess it also technically makes me the longest continuous member of Hypatia, because the founder has gone on to kind of bigger and better things since then. All right, so our mission at Hypatia, to sum it up from our website, is to work to end the homelessness and disenfranchisement of people who experience trans misogyny via mentorship, cash relief, community building, and support. All those words are very carefully chosen, right? We're not chosen at random, and actually went through a lot of iteration trying to get at what our mission could be. So one thing that I'm always really interested in how they explain it, is this experience of trans misogyny, right? That phrasing was not guaranteed when Hypatia started. In fact, when Hypatia started, one of the first things the group decided to do was exclude anyone who wasn't a trans woman. That includes trans men, that includes non-binary people. Over time, as kind of their own identity kind of took hold and they started to understand themselves and their mission a lot better, they started moving away from these very strict ideas of misogyny and transphobia. And they kind of came up with this phrase, experiences of trans misogyny. For them, all trans people experience trans misogyny in some way. Right? For them, this is an encompassing term that encompasses all trans women and all trans men and all non-binary people. So while it did take some time, eventually in the way Hypatia is now, Hypatia is open to, as we say, anyone who experiences trans misogyny, which is, as far as we are concerned, the trans community at large. So we do so via mentorship, cash relief, both community building and just general support. Right? And we have five main values that we kind of aspire to in everything that we do. So first is equal access, right, for all members of the trans community. Right, we pledge to serve those who experience trans misogyny in all forms. Right. Although kind of the faces of Hypatia may be trans women, right, we do not exclusively serve trans women. We serve kind of everybody in the trans community. Right. Another value of ours is honesty in all forms of our communication. We pledge to be both true and timely with all of our statements, both publicly and internally, to bring about effective change. Now, Hypatia works as best it can in a democratic model, right? So having honesty internally actually comes to be very important for how we kind of make rules for the group and kind of how we decide to act in a public manner. Another one of our values is self-sustainability, right? Our goal is to kind of avoid any unsustainable agreements or plans. We want to be responsible for our own future. We want to be able to say that no matter what might happen in the world around us, we can still continue to do the work that we are doing. Right? We do not want to be affected by outside forces and outside pressure as much as we possibly can. Another one of our values is empathy. So First and foremost, we are an organization by and for trans people, again, with the exception of myself, who's kind of this odd one out, which is fortunate. I'm happy, right, to be the exception in this case, right? We are truly for and by trans people, right? Everyone who's in Hypatia, everyone who has a position of leadership, more or less, is someone who has lived in the trans experience and continues to live the trans experience. Right? And so we do not intentionally bring about harm to the lives we affect, right? Our goal is to always be a positive force, both in the lives that we're bringing up, right, through our different programs, and those who are already more established in the tech world. And then finally, transparency. So Hypatia is a 501c3 charity organization as of 2016, so it is legally important that we be transparent kind of with our financials, but we also believe in transparency of our processes. So history, I kind of spoke a little bit about with Lillian. So self-programs. So we offer kind of an interesting array of programs. So the first program that we ever came up with for Hypatia is an emergency cash relief program. So you might be thinking, what does emergency cash relief exactly have to do with tech? Well, and this is kind of one of the ways we think about ourselves as being kind of complementary to maybe other more quote-unquote mainstream diversity in tech groups that you may have heard of, like LGBT, for example, is we kind of know because of the population that we're serving, right? It is impossible to teach people how, right, to learn to do computing work if they are hungry, right? If they do not have a roof over their head, if they do not kind of have the basic needs and necessities of life already met. So the first thing that we decided to do with whatever money comes in is set a chunk of that aside to make sure that everyone who is in our community, who needs a meal, right, who needs to pay rent, who needs medication, whether that be HRT or something else, right, that we have the ability to fund them to be able to do that. Because there's no way that we could be successful, right, in kind of raising a new generation of trans hackers if they don't have all those basic needs met. So that's our kind of first, earliest, and longest running program. The one that we kind of publicized the most, and I have gone to speak particularly about this program at different other tech conferences, like I was at Siegel a couple years back talking about this, is our community peer mentorship program. Right, so the way that is generally structured is we are always actively seeking trans women and other trans people who are out in the tech world who want to donate their time and their skills. Right, we are looking for you in particular. We have students who want to learn your skill. Right, we've at this time kind of focused on Python for kind of like basic web dev and kind of other basic programming work and basic system administration skills. But that is not the only things we are interested in teaching. We are kind of interested in taking on whatever skills you have, right? Because we almost certainly have students who are interested in learning those skills. So we're looking for you, right? We're looking for your help and your energy and your skills, right? And we're pairing you as much as we can to do one-on-one work with the trans women that we're trying to focus on, right? The homeless and impoverished trans women who are looking towards tech as a way to kind of get that first job and kind of break out of the cycle that they are currently in. Those are our two primary programs. We have other smaller ones. We do run a smaller program for students who don't actually have a computer to get them laptops. We've actually kind of inherited and got a whole bunch of laptops that we have other students actually fix up as kind of part of their learning and their training. And then we send those out to those who need them. I do want to talk a bit about how we both see ourselves as similar and different from other communities, right? If you think about groups like outreaching, right, they're really trying to kind of get internships for not just a small subset of, right, minority groups in tech. Their vision is much larger. Their vision is anyone who might be underserved in the tech community, we will try, right, to help you to get an internship in a company that you've heard of, that you know of, that will hopefully spawn some sort of, right, future employment, future love of tech as an industry, right, and future career path. We kind of see ourselves as complementary to that in the sense of, right, for one, we are targeting a particular group of people, right? That is both our greatest strength and for some, one of our greatest criticisms, right? Our goal is, right, not to, right, experiences as like people who experience trans misogyny, there's that connection that's already built up there. So that's really what we are looking for kind of as our community, right? So we're looking to kind of funnel those people kind of into outreach and do that kind of work, right? So our goal is to make sure those trans women are in a position where when they do get that outreach or other grant, they have the skills and they are ready to actually go about and do and make that really happen. All right, so I want to talk a little bit about the future, and then I'm getting the spin, hurry up sign, so hurry up. Right? As I started the talk, right, we all know kind of the reality of diversity in tech, right? There are some pockets that are really good. There are some pockets in open source that you'll never kind of run into these problems, and they've done a lot of really good work to make sure that doesn't happen. And right, you definitely have to shout out groups like feminism for making that work. But if the recent news has told us anything, there's kind of a long way to go for a lot of this tech community, right? So for us in Hypatia, the future kind of looks, first of all, very bright, I think, but also a way for us to kind of explore new avenues that we haven't done before. So one thing that is a common criticism of Hypatia is that it's a very white organization. That is something we are hoping to change. We're hoping to put trans women of color and other trans people of color into leadership positions in the near-term future, right, to kind of diversify even within ourselves what is possible and what is real and what is actually possible within tech. We are, of course, always looking for people who are willing to join us, whether that join us through donations. I'm never not going to shill for donations for Hypatia wherever I go, right? Remember, you donate to us, we are a 501c3. Your donations are tax deductible, right? We are always looking for mentors, and we're always looking for students, right? This is kind of a never-ending process, right? Unfortunately, as much as I hate to say, right, there's almost never going to be a time where there isn't somebody who could benefit from what Hypatia is doing. And of course, we've always said that wasn't the case, but the reality is, right, in this line of work, you will always, there's always that kind of next person who hasn't heard about you yet, but can truly, truly benefit from what you are providing to them. So we're always, always, always looking for kind of the next generation of students for ourselves. Okay, that is it for me, because I already see that I'm being forcibly yanked off the stage. But I'm always happy to talk about this. I talk about this a lot. I'm a professor, like I mentioned, so I can talk all day if you. Let me, but it won't. However, I will say, students, because I know some of you are probably watching me at some point, if you tell me how great or bad this was in class later, I'm going to ignore you.
Alright,
so
any...
that's it for me. Yeah. I can take questions now. I'm going to be here, so I just take questions kind of over the rest of the night.
I would say we could take two or three questions now,
okay,
if anyone has
now.
Any about the organization or about like projects they work on. I actually have two quick questions myself. One, kind of a more serious question of, are you guys going to look into more programs to sort of like, kind of like the way like martial arts is, where you have like, when you train people to do like different levels to pull them up?
Yeah, so we are kind of also in the middle of a rewrite of some of our curriculum. For now, our goal is to get people kind of into their first tech job.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's kind of where we're aiming. Right? Our hope is, well, through building that particular community to that particular kind of skill set, if we get a rich community of employers who are willing to, right, give, right, our graduates, as we call them, right, a chance in their companies, right, and not just giving them a chance in their companies, but also, right, do well in terms of diversity and tech, right? It's one thing to say you're going to do well, and another thing to actually do well, right? So we're kind of also looking for those companies as well. I think after we get to that point, after we're really secure that we've actually made a solid network kind of in the tech employment community and with new batches of students, then I think that will be the point where we would talk about, right, kind of having more levels and to be more complex stuff. I think until that point, we are choosing to focus our attention there. And I think for us it's really important to have a network of trans women within these companies who can do things like, right, letter of recommendation, do things like turn around and then be mentors for the next generation, right? It's kind of stuff like that. So I would love to see that at some point, but I think we kind of have to focus more towards that immediate goal first, and then once we're kind of comfortable there, then kind of expand.
just because I have you on camera right now, and I'm a giant troll, do you have any interesting comments or stories? I don't know how much you were involved in with the whole Leia Libre boot thing. Does anyone know about that story?
So, my official comment on that is I know far more than I am supposed to, and that is the only official comment I'm going to make on
that. That is fine.
So if you'd like to string me up and torture me for the info, then I guess that's one thing. But short of that, I'm keeping silent, because I know better for my own good.
That's very fine. Anyone else have any questions? Or?
Just curious, so where on the spectrum is the support for non-binary and other not, like, trans women, not exactly, you know, in that way, but more general people who are on the queer spectrum and also experiencing gender differently?
Yeah, so one of the really nice things I think about this phrase, experience. For those who experience trans misogyny, we've also used the phrase experiencers of trans misogyny, is that is a purposefully large umbrella.
Okay.
Right? I think one of the things that we learned really early on was that if we make our umbrella really, really small, we've kind of defined out our own existence. Right? Not that there aren't, right, a population of impoverished, particularly and specifically trans women, but we have learned that much better, both as a group, both as a community, and I think do better for our mission, right, of raising trans women up by making that umbrella purposely as large as possible, right? So we are not going to ask people how they experience trans misogyny. We are willing to say, if you feel like you experience trans misogyny, then you are welcome here. That is kind of the most we are willing to do, right? So if you fall under that umbrella, right, whether that's self-identifying under that umbrella or, right, unfortunate life experiences that kind of force you into that umbrella, we love it.
Just say if anyone has one last quick question, otherwise we will go on to the next quick talk.
Like I said, I'm here, so I'm happy to talk. I talk too much anyway.
Okay, if anyone does have anything, thank you, Brian, for that.